Okay. Good evening, everybody. Bonsoir, Kwe. I would like to begin my remarks by acknowledging that we are here this evening on the traditional territory of the Algonquin Nation. I'd like to welcome everybody to tonight's Urbanism Lab and welcome those who are watching on the live stream. Bienvenue en particulier aux nouveaux participants ainsi qu'à nos participants les plus fidèles. Merci d'appuyer les labos d'urbanisme et la CCN en général. I'd like to thank my colleagues who are here who help put this together, and this really is a labor of love that we do every month that we put together these Urbanism Labs. Tonight, in honor of Black History Month, we're going to explore race and culture in an urban setting. More specifically, why some ethnic and cultural groups find themselves geographically segregated from other populations. If you've ever spent any time exploring cities, you'll have noticed that almost everyone has a Chinatown, a Little Italy, beaucoup de villes ont un quartier grec, un quartier somalien, jamaïcain. Dans de quels quartiers les commerces affichent qu'ils peuvent servir la clientèle en polonais, par exemple, où on trouve des journaux imprimés en alphabet cyrillique? These neighborhoods and enclaves add spice to urban life, and our cities would be poorer without them. But have you ever wondered why our cities have evolved this way? Is it by choice, or is it by chance, or for some other reason? Tonight, we're fortunate to have with us a panel of experts who have given much thought to the dynamics of ethnic segregation in our cities and the implications for public policy and planning. Firstly, I'd like to introduce our guest moderator, Lila Viswanathan, who's at the far end. Dr. Viswanathan is principal and founder at Viswali Consulting and associate professor at Queen's University Department of Geography and Planning, with cross appointments to the School of Environmental Studies and the Department of Gender Studies. She's also the principal investigator with the university's Planning with Indigenous Peoples Research Group. Madame Viswanathan a reçu des prix en enseignement. Elle a une grande expérience de la consultation auprès des gouvernements et des organismes communautaires. Ses recherches ont porté sur les thèmes de la race, des lieux et des relations interculturelles. Joining this, Dr. Viswanathan on the stage, we have Karen Flynn, Associate Professor with the Department of Gender and Women's Studies and the Department of African American Studies Program at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. Dr. Flynn, who earned her PhD at York University in Toronto, is particularly interested in matters of migration and travel, Black Canada, health and popular culture, and feminist, diasporic, and post-colonial studies. A much-published contributor to a number of print and digital publications, she is also the award-winning author of the book Beyond, Moving Beyond Borders, Black Canadian and Caribbean Women in the African Canadian Diaspora. Next, we have Sandeep Agrawal, professor and director at the Urban and Regional Planning Program at the University of Alberta. Dr. Agrawal's areas of expertise include land use planning and design, international planning, multiculturalism, and human rights and planning policy. His research over the years delves into the effects of immigration, religion, and culture on urban areas in Canada and around the world. Se joint à nous ce soir Madame Boshra Manai, docteur en philosophie. Madame Manai est coordonnatrice générale à Parole d'Exclus, un organisme sans but lucratif de Montréal qui lutte contre l'exclusion sociale et la pauvreté. Cette chercheuse a fondé son doctorat sur la répartition de la population maghrébine à Montréal et la façon dont elle y est perçue, une étude en lien avec son intérêt pour les questions ethniques, l'immigration et la cohabitation dans les villes. Ses recherches portent aussi sur la radicalisation au Québec, en France et en Tunisie. Elle a consulté de nombreux organismes communautaires pour ses recherches dans la section québécoise du Conseil national des musulmans canadiens. Also with us tonight, last but not least, is Louisa Veronis, Associate Professor in the Department of Geography, Environment, and Geomatics right here at the University of Ottawa. Dr. Veronis's interests lie in social and spatial inequality, social justice, and marginalized groups. She has studied Latin American immigration in Toronto, and her most recent research has explored questions concerning the experience of minority groups here in the National Capital Region, as well as the influence of environmental conditions on migration to Canada and the production and consumption of multicultural media. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Viswanathan. Thank you. Merci. Miigwech.
Kwekwe, bonjour, hello. Thank you, Stan, for that lovely introduction and very detailed biography. I appreciate it. It's really a pleasure to be here tonight in downtown Ottawa to moderate tonight's NCC Urbanism Lab that asks questions about ethnic segregation from a historical and policy perspective. Why do some ethnicities end up geographically segregated from other populations? And this Urbanism Lab event explores the history and dynamics of ethnic segregation in the city from ghettos to ethnic neighborhoods. So I'd like to take this opportunity to also welcome our four esteemed panelists. Et bienvenue à tous les membres du public qui sont présents ce soir ici à Ottawa et à tous les autres qui nous regardent en direct et en ligne. So, how things are going to go tonight is we're going to have each panelist give a 5-minute presentation backgrounder to their work, and that will be followed by me asking 4 questions. And each question will be directed to one of the panelists. And then the rest of the panelists will have an opportunity to share their insights as well. Following that, we haven't forgotten the public. Everyone's going to have maybe not everyone, but if folks want to have an opportunity to ask a question and to engage with the panelists, they will have the opportunity to do so. So, without any further delay, I would like to ask Dr. Karen Flynn, Associate Professor from the Department of Gender and Women's Studies and Department of African American Studies Program from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign to begin. Welcome, Dr. Flynn.
Thank you. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Okay, so, you know, I tell folks that I go to a black church, and so we have a call and response. So when I say hello, good evening, so happy to be here, I expect that folks will respond and say
hello.
Thank you. So I want to begin by saying thanks to Stan and, for inviting me to come back, in a sense, home. I did a lot of my research at the archives here in Ottawa. So in the spirit of Black History Month, I'm going to begin with a quote from one of the interviewees from my book, Moving Beyond Borders. And she says, in her recollections growing up, Kathy Williams had this to say: "I grew up in a big, successful Black community in Chatham, Ontario. We fought hard. I tell some of the West Indians, they think it was a hop and a skip here. It hasn't been," unquote. So before I talk about what Kathy's statement or interpreter statement, I want to just talk about a little bit about what I see as a lacuna in the research on black migration to Canada. So we know a lot about freed slaves. We know a lot about the Underground Railroad. We know about the Loyalists. So we pretty much know a lot about the 19th century. We also know a lot about the 20th century, about Caribbean migration, sort of post-Second World War, when Caribbean migrants migrated here primarily as cheap, exploitable labor. So what we don't know about is the 1920s and 1930s and the 1940s, when the nurses that I interviewed for my book, what their experiences were like in growing up. So I want to think about the question of the city, the urban space from the perspective of these young women growing up in the 1920s, 1930s, specifically in Windsor and Chatham, and this idea of the intersection between race, space, and place. So the question that I'm asking myself is this: what does an urban space, how does an urban space differ, rather, from the rural space for Black Canadians? Okay, and I'm talking about those the descendants of those, the loyalists and enslaved and free Black people and loyalists who made Canada their home. And the first, so there's three points that I want to make. The first is the city brought employment, the city brought increased recreation, and the city also brought, employment and recreation. So in terms of employment, the majority of Black men in particular prior to the Second World War often worked in seasonal and casual employment. Several of the interviewees that I interviewed, their fathers worked in a woodworking company as a night watchman, a barber, cutting hair. And in fact, most of them faced insurmountable odds trying to find full-time work. And overall, they all worked at menial jobs to support their family. In terms of employment, nursing. At the time that the women that I interviewed wanted to enter nursing schools, Canada had an exclusionary policy against admitting Black women, young Black women and teenagers who wanted to enter nursing school. Part of it was this fear of Black hands on white bodies. And eventually, when the nurses were admitted to schools, they actually argued that there was this other unspoken policy, a policy that allowed only two Black young women to be admitted at the same time. The rationale for that is, well, white students didn't want a room with young Black women, and the other rationale was that nursing administrators might have been afraid, really, to have Black students room with white students. But after the war ended, the city provided more employment for Black Canadian men. In fact, one of the interviewees that I spoke with, her father found, and other Black men found, full-time work in the automotive industry where they were paid relatively well, and for the first time experienced job security. Besides employment, the city also provides housing. But we know that in a lot of cities across Canada, there were restrictive ordinances that were set up where Black people weren't allowed to buy land or purchase housing, and a lot of rental discrimination. In fact, what the city also provided was a range of activism. So in response to discrimination in housing, rental, and employment, we see a lot of activism that emerged in places like Chatham, in places like Windsor. And I'll talk a little bit about one of the nurses and the role that she played in developing and starting an organization.
Thank you, Dr. Flynn. Next, I invite Dr. Sandeep Agrawal, Professor and Director, Associate Chair from the Urban and Regional Planning Program at the University of Alberta, to present. Welcome, Dr. Agrawal.
Okay, thank you very much. I see slides. It shouldn't come now. It should come later, but it's okay. Again, thank you very much all for coming, and especially thank you to Stan, Leela, and NCC for having me here. So I've been asked to give this 5-minute introduction, so I'm going to stick to my script because otherwise I'm going to just go over time. So I'll let the slide be there. So while we Canadians celebrate ethnic diversity, we may also experience an undercurrent of private disquiet about emerging and distinctly ethnic residential neighborhoods, namely ethnic enclaves. There may be worry about the racial segregation of visible minorities, fear that these enclaves isolate residents, specifically immigrants, and interfere with their integration into Canadian society. The dreaded watchword is ghetto. In European countries, these ethnic enclaves often raise fears of social division and unrest so that the politicians advocate for policy that will inhibit the minority clusters. One camp sees ethnic enclaves as downside of multiculturalism, representing the failure of the new country to compel immigrants to integrate, or better still, completely assimilate. The other camp views them as evidence of discrimination and racism in job and housing markets. What is missed in both of these perspectives is this: ethnic enclaves are more than just residential concentrations of particular minorities. They are areas where minorities build community life by developing places of worship, institutions, services, and businesses. They are districts with vibrant cultural life and robust economies, where residents have high social capital. Ethnic identity reflects shared religion, customs, language, culture, and history, and is the most striking identity of any individual. Enclaves are simply an expression of this identity. And great examples are various Chinatowns, Ukrainian villages, Little Italy's, India bazaars of Canadian cities that Stan mentioned before. They're among the high points for visitors. The key to appreciating them is recognizing that ethnic enclaves are not the same thing as ghettos, which are the product of poverty, exclusion, and physical disadvantages. Unlike the US, most Canadian ethnic enclaves do not struggle greatly with these concerns, nor does living in such enclaves isolate residents. An ethnic resident is bound to have social encounters outside of the enclave with those of different backgrounds in places like stores, parks, bus stops, workplaces, and so on. All enclaves, urban or rural, are anchored in their respective ethnic institutions, services, and community spirit. The top six metropolitan areas out of 35, where 75% of all immigrants settle, are Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver, Calgary, Edmonton, and Ottawa. In all of these places, enclaves include not only neighborhoods of non-white immigrants, but also long-established whites of European ancestry. And that's where this slide should come. So this is Toronto. As you can see, the Toronto metropolitan area especially has become what I call, quote, a federation of culturally differentiated municipalities, unquote, linked together by the regional infrastructure and civic services. This is the new image of the Toronto area, a multicultural, a multifocal metropolis of majority-minority population. In the cases of Calgary and Edmonton, the earlier immigrants, Ukrainian and Germans, came largely from the agrarian societies of the time and settled in farming practices in the rural areas of Alberta. Conversely, Toronto's early immigrants were Italian, Jewish, and Portuguese, settled directly in central urban core. The booming economy of Alberta, at least until 2015, drove the growth of especially Chinese and South Asian enclaves. Most neighborhoods in Calgary and Edmonton consist of mixed ethnicity with no group, one group predominating. Enclaves offer many advantages and some challenges. They allow the building of a critical mass for the economical delivery of social, health, civic, and settlement services. They foster an ethnic economy, incubate new economic activities. Enclaves also help break the monotony of suburbs. Some of the best ethnic food is available in these places. So thanks to ethnic enclaves, the action now is in Canadian suburbs. However, enclaves should not become places exclusive to their respective ethnicities. People of all ethnic stripes should feel welcomed. So all in all, here's what I'm going to say. Enclaves are here to stay and will likely keep growing. They are the building blocks of the new emerging polycentric forms of these metropolises. We just need to remember that enclaves are not a barrier to social inclusion, Frankly, even if they were, we currently have no policy instrument to direct people away from living in neighborhoods of their choice. Any attempt at such a policy instrument will infringe upon our charter rights. And really, would we want that? Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal. Maintenant, j'invite Dr. Boshra Manai, coordinatrice générale à parole d'exclu. Oups. À parole d'exclu à présenter. Bienvenue, Dr. Manai.
Merci. Alors, bonsoir à tous. I will be your French immersion. So je vais parler en français. Dans la première partie de la conversation, l'idée c'est un peu de nous introduire, en fait, d'introduire notre propre parcours de recherche, puis propre posture en fait sur cette question-là. Moi, j'ai envie de vous inviter à une sorte de. J'ai juste trois images. Je n'ai pas fait de slide trop complexe, ni de carte. L'idée, c'est que je voudrais qu'on parte de l'image de la carte postale, de ce que la ville, en fait, a besoin de produire comme image très symbolique. Et dans le fond, vous voyez l'image, hein ? Oui. Ça, c'est une roue qui a coûté plusieurs millions de dollars et qui se situe à Montréal-Nord, qui est un quartier dans le nord de la métropole montréalaise et qui est un quartier connu pour être, disons, le plus pauvre du Canada, celui où il y a énormément de diversité culturelle, etc. Donc il y a énormément de stigmates qui entourent l'espace, enfin ce quartier-là. Et l'idée, c'est que j'aimerais qu'on, en tout cas dans la façon avec laquelle je voudrais m'introduire et introduire mes recherches, c'est de voir comment on passe de la nécessité d'avoir une carte postale urbaine à la réalité, je ne sais pas comment ça fonctionne ça, à la réalité des espaces urbains dans lesquels les immigrants s'installent, les personnes racialisées vivent depuis des générations et qui sont en quelque sorte des milieux de vie. Donc, on fait juste une sorte de petit zoom à travers les trois images que je vous amène. Et donc, mon questionnement autour, dans le fond, de la spatialisation des Maghrébins et des immigrants d'une manière générale et de la cohabitation interculturelle ou des enjeux d'altérité dans les espaces urbains ont commencé à travers un groupe qui est celui des immigrants venant d'Afrique du Nord, qu'on appelle plus communément des Maghrébins, qui sont aussi, il faut quand même le préciser, des immigrants musulmans. Donc dans un contexte où les enjeux de cohabitation religieuse peuvent être des enjeux problématiques ou pas, mais qui peuvent être des enjeux à soulever. Mes recherches ont essayé justement de comprendre comment ce groupe-là pouvait, dans le fond, révéler des enjeux et des dynamiques d'inclusion ou d'exclusion. Donc, les questions d'enclavement ou les questions de spatialisation, de l'altérité, si vous voulez, dans les espaces urbains, je tente de les comprendre non pas seulement à travers la symbolique de la présence de l'immigration dans l'espace urbain, mais à travers une sorte d'intersection que je pense absolument primordiale, qui est celle, dans le fond, de la race et de la classe. Et que donc, il faut saisir les espaces urbains dans leur complexité et saisir les dynamiques de racialisation qui peuvent être à l'œuvre et donc créer, dans le fond, des espaces urbains dans lesquels sont reléguées des populations pour la plupart d'entre elles, des minorités visibles ou des immigrants ou des personnes racialisées, donc, comme je le disais, depuis des générations. Donc, je reviens sur l'élément important que doit être l'intersection entre le territoire, dans le fond, et les enjeux de race et de classe. Et donc, j'y reviendrai un petit peu plus longuement tout à l'heure, mais le questionnement que je pense qu'il faut qu'on ait à travers l'histoire sur ce que signifient des enclaves ou ce que peuvent signifier des ghettos urbains, c'est comment, au-delà des enjeux économiques et de conditions de vie, d'une part, donc socio-économique d'une part, eh bien, on peut aussi analyser la question de l'ethnicité et de la race. Et je m'intéresse évidemment également aux effets que cela peut avoir sur certaines catégories de ces populations, que sont par exemple les femmes. Donc, si je récapitule, ce qui m'intéresse, c'est comment la racialisation s'accumule aux formes d'expulsion géographique que vivent les groupes paupérisés et les groupes qui ne s'insèrent pas dans les systèmes économiques ou politiques ou civiques, etc. Donc toutes les formes de mainstream, l'insertion économique n'est pas accessible à tous. Donc qu'est-ce qu'il advient des personnes qui ne sont pas incluses dans un système économique ou dans un système politique ou dans un système de représentation. Et donc mon intérêt est passé... Je peux revenir ? Oui ? Yes. Donc, en 15 ans de travaux sur la question de l'immigration, je suis moi-même passée de la carte postale, où je m'intéressais à l'hyperdiversité, je cite là Vertovec, à la place, dans le fond, des autres dans la ville, tout en comprenant comment ils pouvaient, par exemple, participer à l'histoire ou à l'architecture. C'est-à-dire, l'idée n'était pas de ne pas considérer leur apport, mais je m'y intéressais de façon très symbolique. Et aujourd'hui, mon intérêt est plutôt sur comment on arrive à avoir non seulement un discours, mais également des pratiques égalitaires sur les conditions de vie des personnes de la diversité. Donc passer d'une lecture très symbolique sur l'hyperdiversité à une lecture sur les conditions de vie réelles des personnes qui sont issues de la diversité.
Merci, Dr. Manai. This is an excellent segue to our next speaker. I invite Dr. Luisa Verones, Associate Professor from the Department of Geography, Environment, and Geomatics at the University of Ottawa, to present. Welcome, Dr. Verones.
Bonsoir tout le monde, merci d'être là et merci surtout de m'avoir invité sur ce panel d'experts très estimés. Et merci à Bouchra, parce que c'est vraiment la question de l'expérience des personnes immigrantes dont j'aimerais parler en utilisant le cas d'Ottawa-Gatineau, des endroits qui seront peut-être familiers. Donc je veux cibler en fait et partager avec vous les résultats d'une recherche que nous sommes en train de terminer, qui a été financée par un partenariat de recherche qui s'intitule « Immigration et résilience en milieu urbain ». Et en particulier, c'est un projet qui s'attarde à examiner les expériences des nouveaux arrivants dans les quartiers où ils s'établissent au moment de leur arrivée. Qu'est-ce qui se passe, étant donné que le quartier est quand même l'environnement quotidien où on va rechercher les services principaux dont on a besoin. Donc on s'intéresse aux raisons pour lesquelles ils s'installent dans ces quartiers, mais aussi à l'influence des caractéristiques sociales et de l'espace construit pour leur établissement et surtout pour leur intégration à court, moyen et long terme. Et puis j'ai quelques résultats, et puis moi aussi j'ai des images, et surtout j'ai mis des citations avec les propos de nos participants pour en fait que leur voix, leurs expériences soient communiquées directement par ce qu'ils nous ont dit. Donc nous avons entrepris une étude collaborative avec des partenaires dans la région, à Ottawa et Gatineau. Et puis surtout, nous voulions une étude comparative qui examine, dans ce cas, trois quartiers que nous avons sélectionnés avec nos partenaires, qui, selon eux, ont une forte proportion d'immigrants qui sont nouvellement installés. Et vous les connaissez peut-être, ces quartiers. Et non seulement dans leur expériences de travail, ils savent que si nous vous arrivons, ils sont installés, mais les données, puis là je ne vous ai pas surchargé avec les données du recensement, mais le recensement démontre que ces quartiers-là ont plus du double de la moyenne de chaque ville respective en termes de minorités visibles, de résidents vivant sous le seuil de la pauvreté et aussi une majorité de personnes qui sont des locataires. Et là, ce sont vraiment les quartiers hyper divers dont vous venez de parler. Et un paradoxe vraiment intéressant a surgi qui, moi, m'intrigue beaucoup, c'est qu'en fait, les villes canadiennes sont socialement inclusives, mais économiquement exclusif. Alors, malgré le fait qu'il y a une bonne ambiance sociale, je ne pense pas que ce soit nécessairement du racisme ou de la discrimination, mais la classe est le facteur primaire qui, après, intersecte avec la race, l'ethnicité, la religion, etc. Et je crois que nous devons vraiment examiner cette question-là d'une manière approfondie. Donc j'ai quatre diapos avec les résultats. En premier temps, je vais vous parler des espaces construits et les caractéristiques qui sont favorables. Les participants ont dit qu'ils apprécient beaucoup ces quartiers pour leur proximité. Ils sont situés près du centre. Le transport est relativement facile. Des services sont disponibles, par exemple des classes de francisation ou des cours de langue. Des infrastructures, surtout les parcs, des commerces, dont des épiceries ethniques, comme là la boucherie Halal, par exemple, les écoles, les bibliothèques, les centres communautaires, des programmes de toutes sortes. Et surtout, les logements sont à prix plus modique. Les propriétaires sont plus relax par rapport à leur historique de crédit et autres. Et c'est les seuls endroits où ils trouvent en fait des logements assez grands pour leur famille. Par contre, du côté négatif, au point de vue du construit, c'est de très graves problèmes de négligence et de maintien de l'espace construit. Un manque d'entretien des parcs, des poubelles qui débordent, des bâtiments et des logements, comme vous pouvez voir, qui sont mal entretenus, des problèmes d'odeur, de poubelles, le fait que les locataires doivent appeler 10-15 fois, se déplacer au bureau pour demander que la baignoire soit réglée, et ainsi de suite, ainsi que des problèmes de déneigement, des problèmes de sécurité sur les routes, des absences de trottoirs, et puis enfin, que ce n'était pas leur choix premier de s'établir dans ce quartier-là. En fait, ils étaient obligés parce qu'il n'y avait aucun autre endroit où ils pouvaient vraiment s'installer. En ce qui concerne les caractéristiques sociales, c'est vraiment l'inclusion sociale de ces quartiers. Nos participants ont souligné la diversité, le fait qu'ils s'y sentent bien. Tout le monde est différent, alors personne n'est différent. Tout le monde a un accent, je n'ai pas peur de parler. Surtout, je peux obtenir les informations dont j'ai besoin parce que les autres sont aussi des nouveaux arrivants. Je développe un réseau, j'ai accès aux informations dont j'ai besoin. Et surtout, il y a un soutien, une entraide entre voisins, entre les familles, des liens solides, la solidarité. Et en fait, les participants préféraient ne pas quitter ces quartiers parce qu'ils ont peur de perdre ces réseaux-là. Et enfin, la question du stigma qui a aussi été mentionnée, du côté négatif, c'est vraiment l'image négative de l'extérieur qui affecte énormément les participants, les résidents, notamment dans les médias. Alors, un crime qui arrive à Overbrook ou à Harringay est reporté 7 fois dans différents médias, alors que celui de Canada n'est jamais reporté. Aussi l'image négative quand ils disent qu'ils habitent dans ce quartier, les réactions que ça suscite, des enjeux d'activité criminelle, une certaine violence qui les touche directement ou indirectement, mais il y a quand même une ambiance. Et après, ensuite, le problème de la police qui est trop présente ou pas assez présente, qui parfois est un enjeu. Et enfin, un manque de programmes d'accessibilité dû au coût ou de disponibilité de programmes qui sont pertinents pour ces familles, pour ces immigrants, pour les jeunes en particulier. Et la majorité de nos participants étaient des mères qui sont très préoccupées par ce qui va arriver à leurs enfants. Un manque de soutien académique, les camps en étaient coûtent trop cher, nos jeunes traînent, il n'y a pas d'espace accessible et en gros, ils sont à risque. Donc c'est ce paradoxe que je crois on doit examiner.
Merci, Dr. Vernis. So now that we've heard from all four speakers, panelists, we're going to move into our discussion where I have the opportunity to ask a question of each panelist and then open it up to the rest of the panel to share their insights. I believe that our discussion tonight will continue to reflect the physical, socioeconomic, and cultural components of urban communities and the complexities associated with them. So I'm going to begin once again with Dr. Karen Flynn, and my question for you relates to the theme of overcoming stigmatization. Dr. Varonis ended on that point in particular quite graphically in terms of how the media portrays neighborhoods and also from the experiences of the peoples who live in those neighborhoods. So in terms of the theme of overcoming stigmatization in urban communities as well as stigmatization of those communities, I have a question for you. So when we think of Black history in urban Canada, it includes stories of community building, it includes stories of thriving cultural landscapes, and also activism. And in your research, you've explored how urban areas are complex spaces and how important it is for us to understand them in that way. Urban areas are also places that are all too often transformed into areas that are stigmatized, both socially and spatially. So I have a two-pronged question, and we'll open it up to the other panelists to comment as well. So first of all, what are some of the ways that people who live in stigmatized communities resist the perceptions, whether they be founded or unfounded, that are held by people who live outside of those communities? And related to that, as a point of action, how can we as a diverse society develop a more nuanced and therefore more complex portrait of residents who live in so-called stigmatized urban areas?
Okay, so I'm going to answer the first. Let me ask you to repeat the second one, but I'll answer the answer the first one. So I want to go back to my discussion about Windsor and Windsor, Ontario. And so one way in which they resist, at least that community in 1920s and 1930s, resist sort of the stigma or the stereotypes that surround that community, because in Windsor at the time, there was like a 23-acre area where most of the most Black Canadians had lived. So some of the things that they did was developed their own institutions, for example. The churches were one. Their schools, the entrepreneurial activities, businesses, newspapers. And part of this was really resisting the stereotypes of Black Canadians as lazy. As I mentioned in the beginning, there was a lot of activism around around sort of the racial discrimination, the development of organizations. In fact, one of the nurses that I interviewed on the night that she graduated from Hotel Du in 1950, her and her classmates had attended a restaurant to celebrate, and the owner of that restaurant had asked her and the other women, young women that she graduated with in 1950 to leave the establishment because they didn't want Black people in the space. And so immediately after that incident happened, her name is Frida Steele Park, Frida Parker Steele, I should actually have mentioned her name. She started an organization with her father, who happened to be Canada's first Black police, Windsor's first Black police officer and Canada's first Black detective. And so they did a lot of work in Windsor, a lot of which we don't know about. The Central Committee organization worked around employment, trying to get employment for Black Canadians. Another way in which I think that people resist those is through sort of a reclaiming of space, right? So when I talked about Kathy, the woman who I introduced you to at the beginning, it's sort of this way in which people reclaim these spaces, right, that have been stigmatized through what I call somewhat of a citational practice that is visible often in sort of rap music, where people make references to neighborhoods in some ways, right? When she talks about this big Black community and a lot of folks talk about their neighborhood, it's a way of sort of developing a counter narrative of what sort of the dominant society think about these kinds of communities, right? To say we're making this claim to space and to making this and to space and recreate meanings around the communities in which they live. The second part.
The second part, well, I believe in terms of building on your idea, in terms of creating a counter narrative, how can we as a diverse society, and I can open it up to the panel as well,
right.
how can we as a diverse society develop more nuanced and therefore more complex portraits of residents who live in so-called stigmatized urban areas? We saw in Dr. Veronis's work the role that the press play. We are all ensconced in policy discussions as well, and there are larger discussions that happen at the city level. So I'm curious, in terms of our panelists, answering that how question.
I could start. So I agree with what was said before. I think the public narrative, the media narrative needs to change. And I'm going to give some examples, most of which come from Toronto. I'm being an urban planner, so I'm thinking of planning projects, let's say. What comes to my mind is Regent Park and Lawrence Heights, which are social housing projects. But again, keep in mind, these were government-led, large-scale projects, public-private partnerships, and so on, which may not be possible with every neighborhood, especially when it comes to any ethnic neighborhood. So I'll give you an example of this neighborhood in Toronto, and some of you may be familiar with it. It's called Thorncliffe Park. And Thorncliffe Park, high-rise buildings, it's the inner suburb of Toronto, close to the Don Valley. I would say, in many ways, a classic ethnic enclave, 80% visible minority. It's actually an entry point for some of the most educated immigrants coming to Canada. I believe the highest number of PhDs and people with medical degree actually per capita live in Thorncliffe Park. A lot of the small kids, in terms of immigrants, mostly Pakistanis, Indians, and Afghanis. But here are three things. The neighborhood has very high density just because of the high-rise buildings there, very similar to what you showed before, Louisa. High unemployment. So it was not completely unemployment, but underemployment. Low-income households, but very, very low crime rate. So I have been studying this neighborhood for quite some time. I actually lived very close to this neighborhood. And what has changed over the years is the people, what they did to their own neighborhood, these immigrants and refugees who lived in this neighborhood. So today, this place, and again, I'm doing a quick fast forward to today, is a home for best ethnic stores, Iqbal Foods, the best ethnic restaurants like Afghan food, Bamiyan, the best ethnic Pakistani food, Iqbal Sweets. There are a number of mosques. There are Greek, Macedonian, and Cypriot, and Orthodox churches. And the work of the community agency, Thorncliffe Neighborhood Office, that worked with the local residents. So it's a combination of all of this that has actually moved this neighborhood forward. But I'll tell you, it's a pivotal moment. This goes back to 2007, 2008. Thorncliffe Park was part of the constituency of Kathleen Wynne. And Kathleen Wynne was not the premier at that point of time. But the race was a pretty heated race between Kathleen Wynne and John Tory. And this neighborhood became the ground zero. And what happened was that it's the political engagement, the civic engagement of the residents of the neighborhood. They brought up the issue about the schools, the library, the sidewalks, and transit, and so on and so forth. And again, what you see, investment in the school is one of the largest public schools in Toronto now. It has about like 5,000 kids. A new library. Transit routes have been changed. So I think a number of things have happened, including the engagement of the residents of the neighborhood. So I'll just stop at that.
Dr. Veronis?
Yeah. If I may add, I think just look at who's doing the representing.
Yes.
And I think it's training, really, the residents of these areas to represent themselves, provide communication skills. I was thinking, you know, training the youth in photography and journalism, doing essay competitions, and obviously, you know, social media and so on. So I think diversify who's doing the representing. And I think that will change and provide a more diversified image to start with. And then plan events. Take this event there. why are we meeting here, downtown, across from the NAC? I mean...
Because we need simultaneous.
Yes, among other things. But bring people there, do those events there. And it's not just about, you know, positive images and so on, but make it a normal neighborhood where things are happening. And these are two of the things I could think of for now.
Okay. I'm actually going to move on to the next question, if that's okay, because I think there's going to be some overlap. To think about whether we're putting the onus on communities to represent themselves and take responsibility, or whether there's an opportunity to share this responsibility, I think you've started to touch on two of those aspects, and I think we're going to continue in that direction with the additional questions. I want to just come back to Dr. Agrawal and ask you, Sandeep, to bring us back to these concepts of ethnic enclaves and ghettos just for a moment. Ethnic enclaves and ghettos are both top-down and bottom-up constructs. They're defined in that way, and in some instances, we can grasp the collective imagination of those communities, and in other ways, there are external pressures and prejudices that put labels on these communities as well. So could you, first of all, unpack these concepts for us, but more importantly, discuss some of the barriers to social integration that people who live in each kinds of these neighborhoods face?
Sure. So I'm a planner, so you would find that I like clear definitions. I'm a data geek as well, so I'll get into the numbers. But let me just say first thing, ethnic enclaves is a neighborhood where one ethnicity dominates. So numerically, you have more number of people belonging to one ethnicity. But just by living side by side does not turn a neighborhood into an ethnic enclave, and that is the key part. It's what comes next. It's just the number of people who are living there that may spawn into institutions of different types, businesses, services, places of worship, mosques, and gurdwaras, and mandirs, doctors who speak the same language, other linguistic, you know, services that are much more culturally appropriate to the ethnicity that dominates that area. So essentially, it's just not the numbers, but a neighborhood which is institutionally complete forms an ethnic enclave. But I would go back to what I was saying before. In my opinion, ethnic enclaves in Canada are formed by choice, not necessarily by discrimination. No one tells people where to live. It's people's choice, yes, driven by some market forces, yes. You know, people have preferences to live, you know, with their friends, relatives, compatriots, close to a highway, workplace, schools, whatever those things may be. But I think it's a choice. It's driven by choice rather than outcomes of discrimination. So it is wrong to think of these places as sort of symptoms of overt discrimination or some kind of social pathology. Now, ghettos are a little bit different. There are external forces involved. They're usually driven by poverty. You have blightness, discrimination from outside, and you would see that as well. I mean, you wouldn't see so much in Canada, but you would see instances of that in the US. So if you go back 20 years from today, Canada had essentially borrowed this idea of ghettos from the US and was using that to talk about ethnic enclaves. So we actually, back in 2002, 2003, clarified this whole idea of ethnic enclaves and ghettos and how different they are from each other. So I'll just stop at that for now.
Okay. Following up on your points here and even the last question, I didn't get a chance to ask a question around policy implications. So what are the policy implications of being forced to choose to live in a neighborhood or that's defined by ethnicity and class?
To me? Question is to me?
Well, I'll open
yeah.
it up
okay.
to the, I'll
sure.
open it up to the panel.
So let me
yeah.
talk about ethnic enclaves and not ghettos per se.
Sure.
So ethnic enclaves. So we did a study and it was sponsored by the region of Peel. And essentially this was the question that
that was asked of us to see if there are specific demands or services, are there any policy implications vis-a-vis ethnic enclaves in Mississauga, Brampton, and other areas. What we found was that actually not much, quite frankly. Over time, these neighborhoods had the same preferences, need for services, municipal services, or otherwise, as any other neighborhood. But I would say that when we think of immigrants or ethnic minorities, it's not a homogeneous block. You have the essentially two broad streams. You have immigrants who are quite resilient and self-reliant, and then you have others who may need some help. So it just depends. But most of the time, I think they are quite self-reliant. But yes, what ethnic enclaves does is it provides a critical mass where all kinds of services can be delivered. So for instance, English classes, link classes, the federally run English classes. If we know that there is a neighborhood where there's a need for English class, then that is the appropriate place to have link classes to be held. There's a need for linguistic and culturally appropriate services of different types. The need for different kinds of things like, for instance, rerouting the buses and bus routes, because the seniors who were living, the women with kids who were living in these neighborhoods, wanted to go to, let's say, gurdwaras or mandirs, and then go to the babysitting places and things like, which were not connected with the bus route at the time. So there are those kind of things that do come out of these neighborhoods. Otherwise, they are any other regular neighborhood.
How do the other panelists respond to this? Because I believe that Dr. Agrawal has also pointed to policy at different levels. So federal government policy that translates into programs like language, but also municipal issues around transportation. And we didn't get to healthcare as well and a variety of different services. I'm wondering if there are any other thoughts that you'd like to add. Dr. Manai?
Je pense qu'effectivement, il y a une propension à ce que certaines catégories de migrants puissent avoir le choix ou puissent choisir les espaces dans lesquels ils peuvent s'insérer dans la ville. Personnellement, ce que je peux regarder, c'est aussi les espaces dans lesquels au final, certaines catégories de la société se trouvent à être un peu trapped, à être prises un peu au piège. Et je ne sais pas si vous vous rappelez de la troisième photo, mais il n'y avait pas que des personnes racisées sur ma photo. Il y avait aussi des personnes blanches, on va le dire comme ça. Et le questionnement, moi, qui m'intéresse, puis je vais le développer probablement un peu plus tout à l'heure, mais c'est comment certains espaces de la ville, parce qu'ils sont désinstitutionnalisés, on parle du découpage urbain, mais ce que la ville veut dire aussi, c'est est-ce que c'est un espace qui permet l'accès à toutes et tous aux institutions de notre société. C'est un espace d'inclusion, c'est un espace d'intégration, on va dire, institutionnelle. Et donc, pour moi, ce qui est important, c'est de différencier les espaces qui sont des espaces, par exemple, d'enclaves ethniques par choix, mais qui sont quand même habités par les institutions de notre société, et ceux qui le sont un petit peu moins. Puis je pense que ça, c'est une distinction qu'il faut avoir à l'esprit.
Parfait. Tu veux ajouter quelque chose ou...
Je pense un tout petit détail. Comme Sandeep le disait tout à l'heure, il faut aussi se rendre compte du fait qu'il y a des grandes différences dans ces populations. Et en particulier, c'était le cas dans notre étude avec les 37 participants. Certains avaient un revenu bas, mais étaient d'une classe sociale aisée dans leur pays d'origine. Et avaient plus de facilité à parler la langue. C'était une question temporaire de quelques années jusqu'à ce qu'on trouve la job, etc. Par contre, d'autres, une majorité étaient des réfugiés qui n'étaient pas préparés à venir ici. Le Canada les a parrainés, leur offre des programmes généreux, mais ils ont besoin de plus de soutien au point de vue linguistique, d'autres caractéristiques, d'autres besoins qu'ils ont. Et là, en fait, on remarque une différence entre ces deux populations. Et je crois qu'il faut aussi se rendre compte que certains des immigrants, ce n'est pas par manque de volonté ou de résilience, sont les immigrants de la résilience, c'est la raison pour laquelle ils sont ici, mais certains ont d'autres besoins que d'autres.
Et leurs processus d'intégration sont tellement différents des différents groupes.
Ou prend plus de temps. Par exemple, l'apprentissage linguistique est un projet de vie pour certains, puis d'autres, c'est plus rapide.
Tellement. Merci. D'accord. Je vais continuer avec les questions. Je vais poser la prochaine question à Dr. Brasha-Manai, mais je vais donner un peu de contexte premièrement. Les panélistes se sont penchés sur la question de la différenciation sociale et culturelle au sein des collectivités et sur la façon dont cette dernière influe sur la raison pour laquelle les gens décident de vivre où ils vivent ou sont forcés d'y vivre. Alors, j'aimerais que nous approfondissions les aspects économiques des communautés et que nous considérions comment la race, le racisme ainsi que les processus de racialisation sont liés à la stigmatisation, plusieurs stations de la pauvreté. Autrement dit, l'égalité économique et la classe sociale sont des questions essentielles qu'il faut examiner pour comprendre la ségrégation sociale et spatiale. Alors, Dr. Manai, en nous fondant que les recherches que vous avez menées dans le Petit Maghreb à Montréal, nous pouvons entrevoir comment les quartiers ne sont pas simplement divisés selon l'histoire migratoire et raciale, mais aussi selon la classe sociale et le revenu. Les nouveaux arrivants au Canada étaient souvent plus fortement touchés, surtout lorsqu'ils arrivent avec des ressources financières limitées. Il en résulte une divergence entre les efforts déployés par le Canada en matière d'inclusion sociale, s'imprégnant de son histoire de multiculturalisme et l'exclusion économique croissante que l'on retrouve dans les quartiers d'immigrants récents et de nouveaux arrivants racialisés au Canada. Alors, à votre avis...
Tout un programme.
À votre avis, quelles sont les raisons de cet écart, notamment en ce qui concerne les expériences vécues par les migrants récents, les immigrants et les réfugiés au Canada?
Bon, c'est un discours.
Tout ça. Un petit discours.
Évidemment, la perspective que je donne depuis tout à l'heure, c'est celle d'une métropole montréalaise, donc la métropole francophone du pays. Je ne veux pas dire qu'à Ottawa, vous n'êtes pas francophone, mais disons que Montréal est l'espace, la métropole francophone du pays. Ce que ça veut dire, c'est que les politiques migratoires qui ont historiquement tenté d'attirer des immigrants francophones sont aujourd'hui, dans l'espace de la ville, en train de faire émerger, enfin, ou en tout cas de donner à voir ces vagues migratoires-là. Donc, de ma perspective, je parle évidemment, puisque c'était mes recherches portées sur eux, sur ce qu'on appelle les Nord-Africains, bien que je ne comprends pas qu'on ait encore à distinguer les Africains entre les Africains du Nord et les Noirs, basically. C'est dans le fond ces Africains, qu'ils soient Africains du Nord ou non-Africains du Nord, mais également les Haïtiens. Et donc, de ma perspective à Montréal, il faut lire comment les vagues migratoires francophones se sont inscrites dans les espaces de l'Est de la métropole. Puis là, il y a en ce moment un enjeu qui est, on va dire, d'actualité assez fort, qui est que les populations francophones sont en train, économiquement, de tenter de relever cette partie-là de la ville qui a été, c'est touchy, qui a été un peu délaissée, si on veut. Donc, en ce moment, il y a tout un développement économique que l'on tente de faire dans la métropole montréalaise, qui concerne surtout l'est de la ville. Je vous laisse deviner, les immigrants haïtiens, les immigrants maghrébins, les immigrants africains d'une manière générale, lorsqu'ils s'installent à Montréal, ils s'installent plutôt à l'Est. Donc on a en ce moment toute une réflexion sur ce que ça veut dire qu'être une métropole à Montréal, mais où on doit se demander ce qu'on a permis, ou en tout cas ce qu'on a donné comme opportunité à ces populations-là. Puis, c'est certain que le racisme ne peut pas expliquer tout, mais il peut expliquer certaines choses et certains éléments. Et pour moi, la ville est l'espace complexe dans lequel, en fait, on peut lire, si vous voulez, ces dynamiques, surtout de classe, mais également raciales, qui s'opèrent. Donc, ça, c'était une petite mise en contexte pour répondre à votre question. Mais dans le fond, j'ai commencé à travailler très naïvement sur les immigrants maghrébins qui s'installaient dans l'Est, dans un quartier qui s'appelle Saint-Michel, et qui était surtout un quartier habité par des populations haïtiennes. Donc, on avait une présence de Noirs montréalais beaucoup plus importante que des Maghrébins montréalais, qui faisaient suite à, dans le fond, au départ des populations italiennes, donc montréalo-italiennes, qui avaient accédé à la propriété dans la banlieue de Montréal, ou en tout cas dans des quartiers, disons, un peu plus éloignés. Et donc c'est un peu cette succession que beaucoup d'auteurs classiques ont déjà décrit aux États-Unis notamment, mais pas seulement, mais cette espèce de succession des vagues migratoires selon leur classe, selon qu'elles accèdent ou pas à la propriété et donc qu'elles changent entre guillemets de classe sociale. Et donc c'est en observant ce qui se passait auprès des Maghrébins et donc auprès de ces populations-là qui faisait émerger justement des commerces dits ethniques. Donc on a, dans les années 2010, notamment avec des festivités autour du soccer, parce que plusieurs des pays d'origine, que ce soit l'Algérie, la Tunisie ou le Maroc, jouaient au soccer. Et donc c'est des moments de socialisation ou de fêtes qui étaient très importants et qui s'opéraient dans une des artères commerciales. Et donc, là où il est très important aussi de penser aux politiques publiques, ou en tout cas à l'opportunité politique de reconnaissance que peuvent vivre ces populations-là, c'est comment une artère commerciale a fini par s'appeler le Petit Maghreb et est devenue une sorte de symbolique de la présence des Maghrébins à Montréal, simplement parce qu'il y avait des tonnes de cafés, des tonnes de boucheries, des tonnes de coiffeurs dans lesquels, dans le fond, ces populations allaient. En poussant un petit peu plus loin mes recherches, je me suis rendu compte que la présence de ces Maghrébins dans cet espace-là de l'Est était plutôt symbolique. C'est-à-dire que si vous dépassiez l'artère commerciale ou si vous dépassiez la présence seulement commerciale, eh bien, ça n'était pas des Maghrébins, d'une manière générale, ou en tout cas en très grande majorité, qui habitaient cet espace-là. C'était plutôt un espace dans lequel ils venaient travailler. Ce qui veut dire que des espaces comme celui-ci, qui sont encore accessibles avec le métro, et donc là je reviens à nos politiques publiques, notamment de transport, ne sont pas accessibles du point de vue de la propriété. Donc ces immigrants-là habitent en banlieue ou habitent un petit peu plus loin, à Anjou, à Saint-Léonard, dans des villes encore plus éloignées, parfois même plus paupérisées, et viennent travailler dans cet espace-là. En fait, toute cette réflexion sur est-ce qu'on accepte une... En fait, dans quels espaces on accepte une présence réelle ou, dans le fond, une présence un peu plus symbolique. Et je reviens à ce que j'évoquais tout à l'heure, la question des institutions. Dans quels espaces qui sont accessibles du point de vue des transports, qui sont accessibles du point de vue, par exemple, des bibliothèques, etc., on admet certaines catégories quels espaces on laisse à d'autres catégories. Et donc, je me suis rendu compte en voyageant un peu professionnellement vers le nord, donc à Montréal-Nord que je vous décrivais un peu tout à l'heure, qu'il y avait là plusieurs catégories de migrants francophones, racialisés, qu'ils soient d'origine haïtienne ou maghrébine et musulmane. Et les Maghrébins avec qui, par exemple, je travaille plus au quotidien sont ceux qu'évoquait Madame Véronis, des personnes qui sont beaucoup moins, qui ont beaucoup moins de capital, on va dire social ou culturel ou économique, évidemment, et qui n'arrivent pas à se sortir, si vous voulez, de ces espaces qui sont économiquement très stigmatisés et dans lesquels J'aurais pu vous sortir les chiffres, je ne suis pas aussi fan des chiffres, mais dans lesquels les statistiques de paupérisation et de pauvreté sont assez accablantes. Peut-être le seul élément qui, pour moi, est une forme de réponse, c'est que je pense qu'au Québec et au Canada, et vous avez entendu peut-être mon accent, mais si vous ne le comprenez pas, tant mieux, je viens de France. Et donc, de ma perspective française, mais de longue date quand même immigrante ici, nous avons au Québec et au Canada une lacune à comprendre ou à avoir de façon prépondérante l'importance de la classe. Et nous avons tendance, je pense, à comprendre que l'ethnicité, l'altérisation ou la race, d'une manière générale, sont importantes et qu'il faut les considérer. Or, je pense que c'est vraiment l'intersection des deux qui importe. Et je viens d'un pays où la race est tellement éludée qu'on survalorise la classe et qu'on n'admet pas en fait la perspective même d'une racialisation dans la société. Et donc, pour moi, il y a peut-être une réponse aussi dans ce que veut dire une politique multiculturelle ou interculturelle. Est-ce que c'est une forme d'admission symbolique de la différence, ou est-ce que c'est une forme de réflexion sur la redistribution en termes d'inégalité, si vous voulez, notamment du point de vue racial, et si on pousse un petit peu plus loin aussi d'un point de vue, par exemple, de dans quelles conditions on met des femmes racialisées, donc si on ajoute le genre en plus dans certains quartiers. Je travaille dans un espace où un des îlots, est composé de 80% de femmes monoparentales issues de minorités visibles. Donc là, ça inclut des femmes noires d'origine haïtienne et des femmes maghrébines d'une manière générale. Donc on a là des espaces dans la ville qui ne permettent pas, dans le fond, à ces citoyens de vivre une citoyenneté urbaine, en fait, et même une accession aux institutions de la société d'une manière générale.
Merci, Dr. Manai. On va continuer avec Dr. Vérognès, mais j'ai une question à poser avant ça. Mais je pense que ça sera la position qu'on va lancer dans ma prochaine question. I'm curious about the long-term, medium-term, and short-term implications of this intersection, la combinaison of economic exclusion, social exclusion, and then whether it's cultural isolation or whether it's just culture in general, I'm curious what you might think from the city's perspective, the long-term implications, medium or short-term implications of this intersection of all these things coming together, particularly from an exclusionary perspective. And I could open that up to anyone. And Dr. Vérognès, I mean, if you would like to launch into it, but I'm also opening up to Dr. Flynn and Dr. Agrawal as well. Dr. Flynn?
Go ahead.
Yeah. So there's a couple of things first. I think that we have to be careful about sort of the conflation of ethnicity and race, right? Mm-hmm. So first, they're not the same thing. And I think we should sort of avoid that if we're thinking about sort of policy implications. Also, thinking about how different migrants, how different groups of immigrants are situated vis-a-vis each other, right? They don't have, I think it's important to point out, they don't have the same kinds of access to the seats of power, right? Not everybody, not all immigrant groups have that kind of access. And so in terms of going back to the question about policy and thinking about policy, and I'm thinking about a place like you mentioned, Jamestown, and I'm thinking about a place like Jane and Finch, where people, and this is in Toronto, where policymakers, without any kind of consultation from citizens, created these high-rise, these high-density areas, and subsequently, I think about that kind of the structural decisions vis-a-vis an immigration policy. And I'm looking particularly at Caribbean migrants, from the pretty much the English-speaking Caribbean, who came to Canada post-Second World War. Canada had an immigration policy that was exclusive to people of color, right? That you weren't allowed, like a color bar that existed. And when this country was in need of labor, like cheap labor, that is when the doors were opened up primarily for unskilled labor. So then these people came, assumed jobs that white people didn't want, right? And then they ended up, most of them, in these neighborhoods because, one, they could afford to live in those communities. And, of course, the policymakers weren't thinking about the fact that in the 1970s, for example, you'd have like 30,000 people moving into the Jane and Finch, that corridor, and wasn't prepared for that. But then when we have residents of Jane and Finch speaking about some of the issues that's plaguing their community, I remember one of the organization that I interviewed way back when, the Jane and Finch Concerned Citizen Organization, and talking to policymakers, they weren't necessarily listening to the inhabitants of those communities. And I think it's important that we hear the voices of people when they're speaking, and we have a tendency in this country because we often point to the U.S. as, okay, the U.S. is this. They have their ghettos. They have their history of the Ku Klux Klan. They had slavery. Well, so did Canada. Canada had Ku Klux Klan. Canada had enslaved people, right? So we often point to that country as opposed to looking within and seeing how we sort of replicate some of the very same things that we're critiquing the U.S. for. Right? And so part of it is, you know, there's a documentary out called, it's not out, it was, have these a number of viewings called sort of Jane and Finch, Mr. Jane and Finch, and it actually focuses on this 80-year-old Mr. Winston LaRose, who is sort of like an archivist for the community. And I thought I spoke to Nagera Contest, she's the director of the film, and she talks about, like, she's not from Jane and Finch, but she talks about how important it is to understand, like, all of the factors that create these. And I don't necessarily use the word ghettos because I find it really, really, really problematic because language is important. And then when we start using these terms, we start to think about the people and live in these communities in the same way, right? So she talks about how important it is to listen to the voices of someone who's an 80-year-old person who's always lived there, because we have racialized perceptions of cities, and we have racialized perceptions of the people who live in those cities.
Thank you so much. And that translates into biases, unconscious ones, and in some cases conscious ones as well, that lead into policies that aren't always overtly understood as racist and as promoting segregation. A term that we don't use in Canada, except when speaking specifically about Indigenous reserves.
Right.
And yet there's a subtext there, which I'm really grateful to you for bringing up to the surface. So thank you for that. I want to keep track of time because I do want the public to have an opportunity to participate as well. So I want to lead to our last theme, which I did want us to think into the future as well, in terms of understanding the trajectory of our history in cities here in Canada, and to explore some of these geographies of race and culture, and not to conflate the two as well. But let's bring it back to Ottawa-Gatineau and in this region. And so, Dr. Veronis, I want us to go back to your research in this region. And you've been considering the factors at the neighborhood scale. So we've been talking about the city. We've also talked about the different scales of government. But bringing it back to the neighborhood scale that shapes or influences newcomers' experiences of settlement and their social and economic integration. Looking into the future, what can be done by diverse individuals and groups in our society, be they government, social service organizations, individual employers, and everyday citizens, to improve the experiences of those who are socially and economically excluded? I want to bring us back to the complexity that we witness when these two are coming together. and to think about it from the scale of the neighborhood.
Thank you. So this is an important question, and these are just starting points. We're going to start small, but I think I'm going to follow on Dr. Flynn's. My first point was really to stress the fact that the residents of these neighborhoods are the experts, and we should start by talking to them and have the voices heard. The other thing I really, really want to stress, and I think it was stressed, is that immigrants, newcomers, and the residents in these neighborhoods are proactive. They're not waiting to be helped out. So I had some of the photos. I didn't get a chance to go in detail, but they're resourceful. They are already organizing. They're providing mutual support. They take care of the neighbors and of the spaces. So some of our participants were cleaning parks. They were organizing haircuts for the kids or giving breakfast for the kids. They were providing rides to the grocery store. They were doing all these things, and they put their own time and energy and even their own resources into it. So I think we need to recognize that they're already doing something, and they need just a little bit of resources to help them do that. So one of the participants said it was so hard for her to access little funding that is actually available because she doesn't know how to write a proposal. She needs to find a partner, an organization to partner with her. Then she doesn't really access the funds, the organization that runs the funds. And she only needed $200 to do a dinner or something like that. So to look at them as responsible residents who know and provide them with those little resources. And then there's the question of institutions, have those institutions present and run programs that are pertinent to these people through consultations in particular, and not consultations after the decision was made so that, you know, to show that actually we went and listened, but anyhow. So even hiring them. And another issue that came up, one of the local community centers, there were outsiders working there. So they didn't have a good connection. They didn't know what the people needed. And they needed little things, like a sewing class where they can learn the language while they're gaining skills. So I already mentioned the activities for youth, particularly leadership, academic supports. And some of the services actually do exist. So another issue that came up is a question of liaison between all the different institutions, between schools, city-run recreational programs, settlement services, employment programs. They're all disconnected. They all exist, actually, but people don't know or don't have the resources. So there is questions of outreach, of liaison that are easy. They're actually not very time-consuming or cost-oriented. So these are some starting points. Another issue that came up very significantly is the issue of having access to space to get together. Mm. And there's a commodification of spaces where basketball halls are being rented out to teams from outside, whereas the local youth sit on the sidewalk and watch the games. So access to spaces, particularly indoor spaces, because that's a place where these people can gather and share meals and network and actually have a good time, considering the difference between Canadian culture that tends to be a bit more individualized and the communitarian or collective cultures from which these communities are coming from. So space, providing space was very significant. These are starting points, and then the big, more infrastructure, affordable housing, affordable transportation. And Ottawa has the subsidized bus pass. We need more of those. Speaking with someone, we're also thinking of things like mobile libraries or mobile grocery stores, particularly for ethnic foods, to have accessible, affordable ethnic foods. So some of these don't require a lot, but the infrastructure is really the key, and that's a big ticket, I guess, to start. And then the representation, and I think you brought up the issue of the responsibility of who has to do that representation. So that's another topic.
Wonderful. I'm wondering if the panelists, if I was just going to ask if there was, if there were other promising practices that that build on what Dr. Varonis has shared, and in the interest of time, I mean, I'll offer Dr. Agrawal has an idea here.
I'll present a slightly different idea, if that's okay.
The more ideas, the merrier.
Okay. One thing I would say that I think we are conflating a little bit ethnic enclaves with poverty. I mean, I understand that there are neighborhoods like Jane and Finch and St. Jamestown and Thorncliffe Park and the others that mentioned, but you saw what the map showed. Markham, Richmond Hills, Scarborough, Agent Court, they're all full of ethnic enclaves. All ethnic enclaves are not poor. So I think we need to be careful what we are talking about. So here's what I'm going to say. The contemporary neighborhood is a community of politeness and limited social relations. Think about your own lives. How much time do you spend in the place where you live? If you are a student, you're probably spending 8 to 10 hours at the university or longer. If you are working, you're probably 8 hours at your work. If you have small kids, you're taking them for basketball, swimming. Just think of how much time and how many neighbors actually you know in your neighborhood. Maybe a few on your street, but do you know 5,000 people living in the neighborhood? Perhaps not. So here's what I'm going to say. So assuming the ethnic composition of one's residential area defines the scope of someone's social life is a wrong way of thinking of this whole ethnic enclave idea. So my suggestion would be, whether it's done at the neighborhood level or city level or whatever that may be, is to strengthen public education, because our kids, they're bound by neighborhood. So it's the public education which is important. Employment equity is important, because whether it's Thorncliffe Park or the neighbors that you, they're looking for employment. Employment equity is important. And it doesn't have to be in that neighborhood. So again, we got to disassociate geography with some of the larger issues that are out there. So increasing employment equity, fostering open society, promoting political participation, and such activities happen at the schools, places of work which may not be in the neighborhood, government institutions, media, sports, arts. So there are a whole lot of sites where social cohesion and other things can happen. It's just not the neighborhood only.
I think building on your point, I think we'd have a whole other panel on mobility and what that means in terms of income mobility and also transportation and people being able to get from one end of the city to the other based on their needs. However, we would like to have an opportunity for question and answer. So I want to thank the panelists for a lively discussion. And and I'm leaving it to the public now. You're having an opportunity to formulate some questions. And while you are formulating your questions, I'm passing the floor to our MC, Stanley Lineone, so that he can go over some basic guidelines about the Q&A process.
Okay, so because we have a large panel, so just wanted to get some ground rules and clarity. So first, when you formulate your question, please reflect on your question. Make sure that it is indeed a question and not a comment. We want to leave period for questions for the panel. Donc, pendant que vous formulez votre question, assurez-vous qu'il s'agit bien d'une question et non pas d'un commentaire. Second, once you have your question, verify that it falls within the parameters of the expertise of the panelists for a response. So, soyez certain que les membres du panel sont des experts dans ce domaine-là. And thirdly, avoid jargon when you're doing it, and try, if you have a specific, if you know the specific person you want to to send it to, that would be great. Donc, veuillez laisser de côté le jargon de vos questions dans la mesure du possible et veuillez adresser à un panéliste en particulier. Sinon, le modérateur adressera la question en conséquence. Et encore une fois, je vous invite à demander vos questions dans la langue de votre choix. So please feel free to speak in the language of your choice.
I'm not an expert at all, but I did read, I read a lot of books on immigration and everything, and there's one that some of you may have read called Arrival City, which examines the question of slums in some cases, but, you know, in big, big cities like Mumbai, but they go to 12 countries, and they talk about the changes within these communities, where people go and how it changes. And they actually did a study. One of them is Toronto. And they commented on where the old Woodvine racetrack was. It became a entry point for immigrants. And the reason why was that there were so many concentrated by circumstance, whatever. My question is, in your thinking of all of this, do you consider the turnover of the immigrants in these communities? That in the one in Woodbine, they determined that 3 years later, the people were all different. Because they'd established themselves, they'd learned the language, they'd established some ideas for being entrepreneurs, whatever, and they had moved on. And it was a different group of people.
Yes.
So I support your idea that they aren't poor neighborhoods. People are very enterprising. In places like Mumbai, there are 10,000 little businesses within one slum, that, and they want transportation. So do you consider this kind of turnover? What happens to immigrants over a few years? What's the pattern? That's my question.
So we have the example that has been offered in Toronto. I'll ask Dr. Agrawal to respond, and perhaps Dr. Manaï, voulez-vous répondre à cette question ici, donner des exemples du Montréal?
I can start.
Yes.
Thank you for your question. So it is Doug Saunders' book, if I recall correctly, and he actually talks about Thorncliffe Park. So it is a race. It was a racetrack. So the U-shaped street right in the middle is actually where the horses used to run. And so back in 1972, when this urban renewal program was on full force across North America, these neighborhoods came up. So Flemington Park and Thorncliffe Park are good examples in Toronto. So you're absolutely right. So I have seen and I have looked at the history of immigrants and refugees coming to Thorncliffe Park and what happened to them. So 1972, when it was built, was mostly white young families, and as you know, economic mobility, as these folks moved on in their income mobility, they moved to suburbs, and the people who replaced them were actually Greeks. And that's the reason, if you go to Thorncliffe Park, there are at least 7 or 8 Greek churches, because Greeks are very much, you know, into building places of worship. Nowadays, they're only 10% Greeks, but you still have institutions in place. So Greeks, and then came a wave of Bangladeshis. So Bangladeshis were there in Thorncliffe Park for about 10, 15 years. They moved out to Victoria Park. And Bangladeshis were replaced by Pakistanis and Indians. And the new wave is Afghanis, because these are, again, affordable places to live. Landlords don't complain when you have a larger household, and Afghani families tend to be fairly large. Ethnic services are in place, and the new ones are coming. I mentioned about the Bamiyan kebab place, which is the Afghan foods. So, yes. As I said, ethnic enclaves are places of transiency. It is not. If you're trapped in that place, I would then equate that place to a ghetto, because it's the trapping, the poverty, the exclusion. Then, you know, then you have completely downhill from there.
And building on Dr. Flynn's point, perhaps there are new words that we can begin to use that bring us into a space to represent that turnover. But I want to pass it on to Dr. Manaï to speak to some of her experiences as well.
Évidemment, la question de comment dire, apporter une réflexion qui intersecte évidemment l'ethnicité ou la race et la classe ne veut pas dire qu'il y a un lien direct entre la pauvreté et l'ethnicité ou la pauvreté et la race. Je pense que ça, c'est comme un élément qui est vraiment très important à apporter. Cela dit, pour vous répondre, en fait, j'ai envie de vous raconter une histoire. Vous avez probablement entendu parler du jeune Freddy Villanueva qui est décédé il y a un peu plus de 10 ans maintenant et qui était issu de ce quartier en fait Montréal Nord que j'ai décrit un petit peu plus tôt. Freddy est issu d'une famille comme le Canada en reçoit beaucoup, une famille de réfugiés venant du Honduras si je me rappelle bien et qui débarque à Montréal-Nord, qui déménage à plusieurs reprises parce que les parents, la situation économique des parents, justement, s'améliore, etc. Et ils ne sont pas pris dans cette espèce de trappe géographique, si vous voulez. Et ils finissent par déménager, comme de nombreux immigrants aujourd'hui à Montréal, dans une banlieue cossue qui s'appelle Terrebonne. En tout cas, classe moyenne assez élevée, quand même. Et donc, ce sont des personnes qui se sont tirés de cet espace, qui ont utilisé cet espace-là comme un espace, c'est parti, c'est pas grave, comme un espace tremplin. Et donc, effectivement, il y a des espaces qui peuvent être des espaces tremplins et permettre une ascension sociale, même aux personnes immigrantes, réfugiées, racialisées. Mais moi, je pense que ce qui... Puis là, c'est passionné. Ce qui m'intéresse, c'est comment certains espaces finissent quand même par produire des formes de discrimination ou être des espaces dans lesquels se produit et se reproduit du racisme. Ce jeune dont je vous parle, qui est mort dans l'espace public sous les balles de la police, on ne reviendra pas sur les détails, n'habitait plus ce quartier-là. Mais il était un jeune racialisé qui venait utiliser l'espace public dans un quartier surcriminalisé. Et du coup, la pauvreté et la racialisation, ce que ça amène aussi, c'est des projecteurs, notamment du point de vue de la présence, surprésence policière, etc. Fait que j'ai envie de vous répondre à la question un peu à l'envers en vous disant, oui, il y a des trajectoires et de nombreuses trajectoires et de nombreux groupes qui vivent une ascension sociale. Mais ce que je pense qu'il ne faut pas oublier, c'est comment certains espaces finissent par un peu déterminer les trajectoires des gens. Et je ne veux pas céder au déterminisme géographique, évidemment, mais nous avons des espaces dans nos villes qui déterminent un petit peu les opportunités et l'horizon des personnes.
Merci, Dr. Manai. The beauty of this panel is offering these multiple perspectives as well. We cannot escape the geographies that we are in. Sometimes they do end up defining us, whether we want to or not. And this is the tragedy of the story that you shared. Thank you for that. I would like to then take another question from this microphone, and feel free to introduce yourself and to ask your question to a specific panelist if you like.
Okay, this is for everyone. My name is Michael Kostchuk. I live in Carlington. It's one of the communities in Ottawa. I'm an occasional teacher. That's a substitute teacher with the Catholic School Board. I actually have 5 university degrees. The reason why I mention that, the question I'm going to ask is, how do people who live in communities that have a negative stigma get their voices heard? Now, the background in Carlington is that it's got a higher crime rate. It has social housing, very similar to Jane. It's got some big towers and some row housing. And about 10 to 12 years ago, they did a big study in Ottawa analyzing all the neighborhoods, and the neighborhood that ranked lowest was Carlington because of lack of services. And of course, that contributes to the lower quality of life there. However, not all of Carleton's the same. You know, you get the lower areas and then you get higher areas. And so we get PhDs that went into Carleton who work at Carleton University, and you got the newer immigrants on the other side, you know. I also attended a conference on gangs, and the premise of that was that people tend to join gangs if between the hours after school ends and when dinner time starts. So if you can actually engage the youth between those two times, it's only like a 3 or 4 hour window, you can actually reduce their chance of joining a gang. Now, statistically, 2 years ago, I saw stats in Carleton where only 46% of the youth are high school graduates. I think that's a horrendously bad statistic, you know. And one of the things I wanted to do when I was president of the community association is get a library put into Carleton, because we lack so many services. And not only is a library a good place to get books, but it's also a quiet place to go study. A lot of students don't have a quiet place after school to go and do their homework, you know, and then go home. So anyway, so that's the background of Carleton. So the question is, how do people in our area who have a negative stigma because the city won't listen to us? I mean,
no. You have the answer.
Yeah. Well, for example, when that study was done,
I'm going to programs that exist in Canada, Pathways to Education being one of them, that offers that opportunity within those two periods of time for kids to get that space. It relates to Dr. Veronis's statement too, the lack of space for gathering. You've mentioned the library, but I'd like to give the opportunity to the panel to honor the fact that these communities have voices, and that it's what opportunities are there to have these voices amplified. If you don't mind me rephrasing the question a little bit, sure. What are the ways in which the voices in these communities can be amplified, given the differences in the different experiences?
I think you need to go to the end of the street, where the PhDs are. No. and talk to the, well, on a serious note, though, I think that I've one of the things that I often think about that is very much influenced by my family, they're migrants as well. My parents migrated to Brampton. No, actually, they migrated around the Jane and Finch corridor, and they're one of those people that left, right? And so they, and then we moved to Brampton, and when I moved to Brampton, there was, you know, like two black families on the street and two South Asian families on our street. Now, if you've ever been to Brampton, it is totally different, right? Like, amazingly different, an enclave, if you will. But one of the things that I learned is that, in terms of when I teach, we have to begin from the premise that all our existence is tied together. Right? So oftentimes in a lot of, that's just it. We have this very, very short time on this geographic space called Earth, and we die, which just sounds macabre, but true. But so how do we build alliances? And that's what I was suggesting, right, about the people at the end of the street who are doing fine. So we have to figure out a way in which we build coalitions with people who have the resources, not in a way that they're telling the people what to do, but to join in, to recognize that our existence is really, our existence is tied together. And I think this is very, you know, sort of Martin Luther King's kind of theology, right? That we ought to care about the existence of other people. And that was something that I saw, like my family did. When new migrants came in, like there was never an empty room in our house, right? They really reached out to people who migrated, who were not, in the position to find even their own in their own housing. And I remember when my dad was, you know, on his deathbed, one of his friends said that he wanted to go on a date. He didn't even have a suit to wear for this date. And my dad gave him like his suit, but he had the monogram of his name. My dad's name's Errol Flynn. And there, Right. And there, the name was, you know, the monogram with my dad's name was in it. But that's just, you know, might appear to be a simple, kind of a simple response. But I think that oftentimes we leave these communities to do the work on their own, pretending that it's just their problem. Let them deal with it. Because part of what we think is that they could have pulled themselves up by their own bootstraps, but that they really didn't.
And that's the flip side of the resilience story, right? When we overemphasize this notion of resilience, we forget the need for empathy in terms of addressing the needs of our fellow person. I do want to follow through. Thank you for the question. Thank you very much. And I'd like to follow through with the next microphone and have you ask your question.
Sure. Thanks. My name is Michael Hoskin. When you're examining an ethnic
enclave... Please speak right into the mic.
Sorry, yeah. When you're examining an ethnic enclave and you are trying to quantify the issues in the enclave and say it's also economically disadvantaged, how do you sort of, when quantifying, how do you tease out the differences between the ethnic problems and the economic problems?
Mm. Who would like to take that very simple question?
So, I can...
the quantifier.
Well, you're not asking for a method, but you're just saying, generally, how do you decipher between the different types of issues?
Yeah, so, like, how do you... like, if you have an economically depressed...
Yeah, so let me just give you sort of a sense of what we did in the region of Peel. So we had, we looked at several neighborhoods based on our measurement that there is one ethnicity that's dominant. And then we had a control group where one ethnicity was not dominant.
Right, okay.
So that's how we could, again, it was mostly qualitative study, but within qualitative study, we tried to control some of that factor. And that's the reason what I said before, that some of the issues were pretty much the similar. I mean, you know, there was the issue of traffic. It was same. It had nothing to do with ethnicity, for instance. There was the issue of the fact that the school was fairly small size. I mean, it's not so much. I mean, there may be some, for instance, in Thorncliffe Park. Just 1/3 of the population of Thorncliffe Park is all small kids under the age of 14. And city hadn't recognized that. But anyways, they did eventually, and they expanded the school and so on. So we tried to do that by controlling the ethnicity.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And our next speaker,
Hi, everybody. I teach geography here at high school's level at the public school board, and very passionate about what you guys are doing, so thanks for coming out. What really resonated with me is the idea that obviously we all care about our communities and where we live, and we all have, you know, we want to have an input, we want to have a say. We're talking about notions. I think Ridgemont High School falls into the Overbrook community. And, you know, I was new to Ottawa 10 years ago. And when one of my first teaching jobs was there, and certainly I was told, you know, oh my God, Ridgemont, blah, blah, blah. You know, but when I teaching there, and I was only there for a semester, and that community, the sense of community at that school has been by far been one of the best communities I've ever been involved with. From a school perspective, and certainly, you know, the staff there certainly play a strong role in that, and as well, but the students as well. You were talking about listening to them because, you know, they're the experts, and you know, because they live there. You know, and that got me thinking, is like, you know, yeah, you know, they certainly are. But in some cases, too, like I live in a neighborhood that's fighting back against intensification, which I think is also very important. And it's like, well, sometimes we do need to listen to other experts who have a different perspective on these things. I mean, from an urban planning perspective, you know, I just think our cities need a lot of work in terms of how we do that. And even your point about how much time we spend in our neighborhoods, like, really stood out to me. Like, I talk a lot about, you know, we're developing, you know, this urban sprawl, and, you know, we're spending more time in our cars than we are in our communities and interacting, you know, with each other, and, you know, and the impact that's having on our cities. But for me, I think a lot of this comes to, like, you know, how much is this? And kind of the guy who's gentleman who was speaking before, you know, is this an issue of democracy, as I feel like, is that, like, that engagement? Because, you know, when I see the city kind of reaching out, it's in ways that, you know, maybe aren't accessible to everyone, or, you know, even that knowledge isn't even getting out. Heck, we had that for the first time ever, the daytime parking ban in the city of Ottawa, and they, you know, put out hundreds of parking tickets, and, you know, and there was, that's a bunch of people just not getting that news and stuff like that. So I'm just, I don't know.
Do you have a question?
Yeah, I guess the question, how much is this, sorry, how much of this is, like, you know, is it an ethnicity issue? Is it, you know, how much, or is it, like, a democracy issue, and who's, you know, who needs to take the lead on that? Is it the policymakers or the local community?
So when you say it, how much is it a democracy issue? Is it the relationship of all of these factors that you're that make up the city and that make up that complexity?
Is basically, that really? Yeah.
Okay, excellent. So we're talking about democracy now. Bashra? Thank you.
Ben, en fait, merci à vous deux de poser cette question-là. Personnellement, c'est évidemment cet enjeu-là qui m'intéresse, mais en plus que je vois au quotidien dans mon travail. Je vais l'organisation dans laquelle je dirige, en fait, que dans laquelle je travaille, s'appelle Parole d'exclus. Et l'idée, c'est de faire en sorte que la parole de celles et ceux qui sont les plus marginalisés, les plus exclus, soit entendue. Mais entendue par qui ? Entendue par ceux et celles qui décident de leur quotidien, dans le fond. Et on travaille sur plusieurs enjeux. Dans un espace qui est considéré comme un désert alimentaire, par exemple, on a développé un système alimentaire, par exemple. Je vais vous donner un exemple qui concerne vraiment le panel de ce soir. On travaille depuis à peu près 2 ans sur un plan d'aménagement d'une section de tout le territoire qui a été... qui n'a pas été pensé. C'est-à-dire qu'on a omis d'inscrire des institutions, donc il n'y a pas de clinique médicale ou d'accès à des espaces de santé, par exemple, etc. Et c'est un espace très, très dense, dans lequel il n'y a pas d'espace vert, dans lequel les appartements sont souvent insalubres, etc. Donc des conditions d'habitat qui peuvent être très difficiles. Et la ville a décidé de faire un plan d'aménagement sur 10 ans, sans consulter, sans se dire que peut-être ceux qui vivent la ville ont leur mot à dire. Et ce que nous avons fait, c'est de s'intégrer dans ce plan de développement. Mais vous avez raison. Les citoyens ne sont jamais respectés comme des experts, parce qu'on a toujours besoin de traducteurs. Et ce que nous avons fait au final, c'est que, parce que nous avons tout un pôle de mobilisation, mais aussi un pôle de recherche. Donc on a des, comme moi, dans le fond, des chercheurs qui travaillent sur le terrain. Et donc, dans le fond, on a fait en sorte que le plan d'aménagement de cet espace qui doit être fait, qui doit rénover une partie de l'espace, puisse intégrer les besoins de la population à travers des consultations et à travers, dans le fond, à travers le fait que leur parole est portée dans les transformations. Et cela a incité l'arrondissement à avoir vraiment une perspective de la parole citoyenne qui soit intégrée, mais qui est intégrée à l'aide aussi de chercheurs qui sont in situ, qui travaillent à partir du territoire. Et je ne dis pas qu'il n'y a que les chercheurs qui peuvent traduire, mais il faut, dans le fond, des personnes qui traduisent, dans le fond, entre des réalités que l'on est capable de regarder ethnographiquement ou de porter ethnographiquement, et des besoins de décider qui sont de planificateurs et de gens qui ont des budgets serrés. Donc des traducteurs entre des réalités de vécu et de réalités justement de construit et de conçu.
Merci, Bashra. Do we have time for one more question? We do. Okay. Quick questions. So let's do the lightning round.
Or maybe lightning take round. Questions and then we can.
So, would you like to ask a quick question?
Okay, my
question. No preambles.
my question is really, have you and how do you consider the intersection of the spatial, formal, legal boundaries of these neighborhoods, because that's the level at which the cities often provide services, versus the sort of natural boundaries of these neighborhoods? Because if you change the boundary definition, your data changes with regards to income, poverty, and all the indicators that you would have about the neighborhood. So how do you ensure that some neighborhoods are not subsumed with richer clusters of neighborhoods and the problem disappears by dealing with the boundary? Thank you.
I can
quick answer.
In Canada, planning was not done at the neighborhood level until just 20 years ago. It's more of a American planning concept to be to recognize a neighborhood and do planning at the neighborhood level. So if you look at Toronto, for instance, the planning used to be done at the ward level, the political boundary, which may have multiple neighborhoods in it. If you take Edmonton and Calgary, neighborhoods are defined by the developer. If a subdivision is that big, he or she calls it a name, and that becomes a neighborhood. So Edmonton, for instance, is obviously not as big as Toronto. It has 140 neighborhoods. You know, so it's quite arbitrary, if I could just put it that way.
Thank you, and we'll have one more quick question.
I don't think it's working. Oh, it is. C'est pour professeur Véroni. Je m'appelle Attila. Je travaille en planification du transport en commun à Gatineau. Le principal enjeu que la communauté fragilisée, vulnérable, disons, l'exemple de Toronto s'applique pas vraiment pour celle-ci, il y a l'accès à l'emploi et surtout l'accès aussi aux services publics. Les politiques de transport en commun peuvent aider en partie à mitiger ces questions-là, mais le développement et le redéveloppement du territoire, comme c'est le cas d'Ottawa, joue un rôle aussi important. Quelles sont quelques orientations qu'on peut donner à la commission de la capitale nationale pour développer les territoires d'une façon plus inclusive.
C'est d'accord, une orientation.
Une. Okay. La question, c'était par rapport au transport ou l'emploi?
C'est l'accès à l'emploi et aux services publics.
Aux services publics, l'accès à l'emploi. Bon, il y a la question du transport, clairement.
Tant de facteurs importants, mais quoi d'autre en termes de développement on peut faire pour mitiger ces enjeux-là?
Ces enjeux-là, c'est une grosse question.
I think this is a game of stump the panelist.
Je pense qu'il n'y a probablement pas une seule solution. Et puis la question de l'emploi pour les nouveaux arrivants, elle est énorme. On sait déjà la réponse, c'est que les employeurs les engagent. Donc, je pense que la sensibilisation des employeurs, on peut commencer par ça. Et il existe des organismes ici à Ottawa, c'est Higher Immigrants Ottawa, en français, c'est Emploi, je ne me souviens plus l'acronyme, qui travaille en fait avec les employeurs pour les sensibiliser à la diversité dans le milieu du travail et surtout les préjugés par rapport au nom des CV que les employeurs reçoivent. Et l'autre grand enjeu, c'est le réseau. On le sait au Canada, trouver de l'emploi, c'est par le réseau. On peut envoyer les CV, personne ne va vous appeler si on ne vous reconnaît pas, si on ne vous recommande pas, si votre lettre de référence. Donc, dans d'autres recherches, c'est toujours la question du réseau et en fait donner l'opportunité aux immigrants, aux nouveaux arrivants, de développer un réseau. Puis là, c'était la question d'habiter dans son quartier, les réseaux qu'on fréquente. C'est très difficile pour une personne nouvellement arrivée. Vous pouvez l'imaginer, vous arrivez quelque part, vous devez développer un réseau. Non seulement vous n'avez pas les compétences linguistiques, vous ne connaissez pas les dimensions culturelles du réseautage de l'endroit, vous ne savez pas où vous tournez, vous ne savez pas où l'information est, vous ne savez pas en fait les stratégies pour obtenir cette information. Donc là, on retombe peut-être dans la question de la liaison entre les différents secteurs de services. Et puis les écoles est un grand enjeu. Donc juste pour dire, notre recherche, en fait, c'était des participants qui avaient des personnes à charge, qui passent plus de temps dans le quartier que quelqu'un qui fait la navette entre son chez-soi et le travail. Donc certaines populations passent plus de temps dans le quartier que d'autres. Donc, la question des liaisons, je pense, est importante. Puis reconnaître que dans les cultures, il y a différentes façons d'accéder à l'information. Certains, moi je l'ai vu dans nos recherches qu'on a fait avec des immigrants francophones d'Afrique subsaharienne, l'Internet, ce n'est pas la façon d'obtenir l'information. Oui. Comment je cherche l'information? Comment je sais quel mot choisir pour trouver l'information dont j'ai besoin? Oh, you just Google. Oui, mais quel mot j'utilise? Je ne sais pas où elle est, l'information. Donc, juste, je pense qu'il faut aussi des stratégies multiples, notamment par la ville d'Ottawa et Gatineau. Ils ont un portail. Il faut utiliser plusieurs langues, plusieurs stratégies, des capsules vidéo, etc. Donc, en fait, c'est pour beaucoup de stratégies différentes.
Merci, okay, Louisa. Je vais passer le micro à Stan.
So, we'll leave it there. Thank you, everyone. I want everyone to join me in thanking this amazing panel that we had. And I want to thank everybody for coming in, some from long distances. And it was great having a guest moderator, so I didn't have to sit there and ask all the questions. So I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Donc, je vous remercie d'être là ce soir. Je vous encourage à venir à notre prochain labo qui est le 3 mars sur le sujet, c'est la faune urbaine. Donc, le 3 mars, c'est la journée internationale de la faune urbaine. So we will be celebrating International Wildlife Day by looking at the relationship between humans and wildlife in the urban environment. March 3rd, hope to see you there. Merci, bonne soirée tout le monde.